So let me welcome everyone to the Nuclear Threat Initiative Seminar Series. I'm Corey Hinderstein, Vice President of International Fuel Cycle Strategies at NTI, and I'll be the moderator for today's session. We're honored to host the International Atomic Energy Agency Director General, Rafael Mariano Grossi. The DG is joining us today to talk about the vital mission of the IAEA and its challenges in this new decade. As we all know, today's global leaders face an increasingly diverse and complex set of challenges. We're in the midst of a global pandemic, as evidenced by our meeting here online. And there are increasing disruptions from extreme weather and challenges and opportunities that come from globalization, hyperconnectivity, increasing and pace of technological developments. So this is added to the already and traditional challenges that the IAEA faces as it works to respond to increasing demands for its support and services. With a flat budget, and in a political environment around safeguards and peaceful nuclear energy that can be, as we said, challenging. And we also recognize the need for strength and safety and security for all uses of nuclear technology. So the DG does not take on an easy job. He has been in the job for just over a year now. And so we think this is a great opportunity to check with him on his thoughts and his priorities going forward. In terms of the agenda for today, we'll have a brief set of remarks from Secretary Moniz, followed by a discussion with DG Grossi. And then we're going to turn to Q&A. Please use the Q&A box at the bottom of your screen to ask questions. Feel free to submit those questions anytime during today's session. If you do see your question disappear, though, don't worry. You don't have to submit it again. It just means that we're collecting the questions and moving them into our document behind the scenes so that we can look at what questions are being submitted. We do know that we'll have many more questions than time. And so I apologize in advance if we don't get to your question, but we are committed to ending after 1 hour. For those of you who are following along on Twitter, either with your observations on today's sessions or comments on the issues, please use hashtag NTI Seminar. That also allows us to go back afterward and potentially answer questions that didn't get asked during the session. With that, I'd like to welcome Secretary Ernest Moniz, who is the co-chair and CEO of the Nuclear Threat Initiative. Among his many achievements and many hats that he has worn, he did serve as the 13th Secretary of Energy before assuming his role here at NTI. So it's my distinct pleasure to welcome him to our virtual stage. Sir, over to you.
Well, thank you, Corey. And let me repeat your thanks to all of you who have tuned in to what we think will be an extremely interesting discussion. And of course, to repeat also statement that we're very honored, really, to have Director General Rafael Mariano Grossi here with us today. Rafael Mariano took on a very difficult job, as Corey stated, but we could hardly have someone with more experience and more training for this challenge. He's a diplomat with more than 35 years of experience in the field of nonproliferation and disarmament, served as president of the Nuclear Suppliers Group, the only person to serve two successive terms in that role. He promoted nuclear security since his role as the Argentine Sherpa for the nuclear security summits. He's been central to managing the vital role of the IAEA in implementing nuclear safeguards in Iran and monitoring the Iran nuclear deal, where I think most of you know he just in fact returned from this weekend. As DG, Rafael Mariano has continued an emphasis that he initiated during his presidency of the NPT Review Conference on Peaceful Uses of Nuclear Technology, holding true to the updated motto of the IAEA, Atoms for Peace and Development. The Director General has been transforming the field in other ways as well. Since 2017, he's been an international gender champion, promoting gender balances in the nuclear arena. He's pledged to achieve gender parity at all levels of the agency staff by 2024. And NTI has been extremely happy to support the new Marie Sklodowska-Curie Fellowship. This initiative will broaden the staffing pipeline by supporting 100 women each year to complete graduate degrees and then work at the IAEA. We invited DG Grossi to speak today about global nuclear issues facing today's leaders, and he'll describe how the IAEA is supporting states' use of nuclear technology. Now, the global pandemic has demonstrated the need for cooperation in responding to the most pressing challenges of today, to which I would add climate change as another. And these all do have links. The IAEA has risen to this task posed by the pandemic, responding to its challenges in these nonproliferation and climate change arenas. One might say a silver lining during the pandemic is how it's afforded new opportunities to connect with people around the world, as we are doing today. Well, look, NTI, I want to turn it over to Rafael Mariano, but it's just to add in closing that NTI has truly valued our strong relationship with the IAEA over 20 years, and now with DG Grossi. And we are so pleased that you've agreed to join us today from Vienna. So I'd like to turn it over to you and for maybe 20 minutes of remarks and then a robust Q&A discussion. Please, Rafael Mariano.
Mute. Now, I hope you can hear me now. Thank you very much, Secretary Moniz and Corey. It's great to see you. It's really an honor to be with you. NTI has been, of course, instrumental to so many things in this area, and I'm delighted to continue to partner with you on a number of issues where we are working together. So I will try to be as efficient as possible in just touching upon a number of issues, looking forward, as you said, to what will be a very interesting exchange. Let me start by saying that the IAEA as an institution has enormous challenges, but also the great opportunity to make real contributions on a number of issues of global relevance at this point in time. When we look at the world and we look at the challenges that we are facing, and at the risk of starting with something that a DG of the IAEA would never start, I would start with the pandemic. This is what is in everybody's mind. This is what is worrying us and our families. And, you know, just a couple of months after I took office, I was confronted with this. And we felt, we were convinced here at the IAEA that this agency could do something about it. And we have been doing just that. We have helped 127 countries by providing them with RT-PCRs, with training, with protective equipment, with tests. And on top of that, we decided to work together hand in hand with the Food and Agriculture Organization, with the World Health Organization, with the International World Animal Organization, and put forward a program which is called ZODIAC, Zoonotic Disease Integrated Action, which is going to highlight more than highlight, use nuclear technologies to help in the early detection of zoonoses. So I think it's important that at this time, the audience and the general public recognizes that nuclear applications and science are also part of the arsenal, are also part of the toolbox that we have to confront this horrible pandemic, which is affecting and changing our lives. And this has been something that has been well received all over the world. Many people ignore that the IAEA could do this, but we have been doing this and we will continue in this path. So I wanted to start with this note on what really matters for everybody out in the streets these days. I should also say that the IAEA is being active on another global challenge of enormous proportions, And here I have in mind the climate change challenge that we all have. From the beginning of my tenure, I said nuclear is part of the solution. Nuclear energy, as you all know, already provides 1/3 of the clean energy which is produced all over the world, and in some countries, like the United States, more than that, because of the proportion of nuclear energy in the national grids. My first trip as Director General was to the Conference of the Parties of the Climate Change Convention, COP, as it is known, in Madrid last year. And we were well received. And so we are already working with the British organizers, and we will be in Glasgow for the next conference, where we will be glad also to see the United States having rejoined the Paris Agreement as an interlocutor of enormous importance. And the IAEA, of course, is not the center of that debate, but is saying nuclear has a place at the table when it comes to the big problem of decarbonization of the global economy. So there, the IAEA is going to be, of course, present as well. Turning now to issues more akin to the and related to the work of NTI and what we have been doing together, nuclear energy is growing. And since, contrary to some narratives that are sometimes taken for granted, we see nuclear energy growing in Asia, especially in China, also in Russia, in India, in the Gulf, in Eastern Europe, in Turkey, in many places around the world, in Latin America, where I come from. So this, apart from the energy specific considerations about this growth, also raises the bar in terms of something that we have been working together for many years, which is nuclear security. I think the nuclear security international regime is also called to play an important role against the backdrop of this growth of nuclear energy and the multiplication of reactors and other facilities around the world. We come from a decade where you yourself and others, and Corey, played very, very distinguished roles in pushing a more ambitious global agenda on nuclear security, and most notably through the series of summits that took place over the past decade, and other efforts to bring the normative structures around nuclear security to a higher level. This was very commendable, but of course, we are at a different time in terms of our work in nuclear security. I think that from these big brush strokes, very visible and very colorful, that were needed 10 years ago or more, now the work needs to continue in a different way, with the same degree of conviction and with the same degree of intensity, but looking at the real gaps that we have. We need to make sure that everybody takes part. We need to make sure that the national nuclear security infrastructures are up to speed. We need to make sure that the new and very real challenges perhaps lie, without wishing to belittle the importance of looking at the nuclear material, at some other challenges like cyber nuclear security and the challenges that we are having in that particular area. So I think we need to adapt our efforts, and at the agency we are trying to do this, of course, looking at the traditional nuclear security agenda, which is very important, but also seeing what needs to be done. When the limelight of the big summits turn off, the minutiae and the detailed day-to-day work takes its place, and it's here. at the IAEA and through the IAEA network that this this comes alive. I'm sure that we will have opportunities to discuss in the Q&A. Another very important issue that I want to use this opportunity to remind ourselves today is, of course, nuclear safety. And rightly so, this year and in a few weeks, we will be remembering the 10th anniversary of the Fukushima Daiichi nuclear accident. And the IAEA, of course, is fully mobilized, not only with a sense of historic or in a sense of historic perspective, which is, of course, very important and must be done, but we are looking into the strengthening of the nuclear safety architecture at all its different levels. And moreover, we expect to be able, as we have been doing over the past 10 years, to continue working with our Japanese partners in the decommissioning effort and also in other very challenging operations, as many of you may be aware, in dealing with the water that needs to be processed and released out of the area of the reactors. And all of these are areas where the IAEA is going to be playing an important central role. Nuclear safety is also something that needs to be looked at with a higher degree of intensity when we see the evolution in terms of design and in terms of the architecture of the new nuclear plants. The trend and the new or the appearance of the small modular medium size reactors is posing new questions in terms of safety and also of security. And the IAEA, as the international hub for all these discussions, is already looking into this hand in hand with national regulators, as of course it should be. So, as you can see, the uses of nuclear sciences and applications to combat the pandemic, the use of them to mitigate other environmental challenges like plastic pollution, nuclear medicine, and so on. The role of the IAEA and nuclear energy in the bigger picture of the climate change problematic. And as I just said, our traditional but evolving, inevitably evolving roles and responsibilities in nuclear safety and security are obvious. And we are going to be prepared from the IAEA to exercise our responsibilities in all those. As I approach the last part of my presentation, I need to say a few things about the current non-proliferation issues on the agenda, which I'm sure are at the top of the list of many of those who are joining us this morning or this afternoon, early evening here in Europe. Of course, these have to be done with the situation in Iran and what we have been doing and trying to attempt last weekend and in general for the past few months against the backdrop of a very difficult situation on and around the agreement that you, Secretary, together with others, shaped and brought into place, the JCPOA, which has been challenged over the past few years and is in a very serious and delicate condition. The last of it in the form of the announcement on the part of our Iranian counterparts that in implementation of provisions of a law passed by the Majlis, the accesses verification competences and activities in Iran would be drastically curtailed as of tomorrow. We believed here in Vienna, I personally saw that with enormous concern. I'm not a party to the JCPOA, but I am the inspector of that treaty and that agreement. And above and beyond that, my concern as nuclear watchdog is that irrespective of the existence or not of this agreement, entering into a new phase like the one that was being announced with the suspension of the additional protocol, the JCPOA specific verification and monitoring authorities would be confronting us. I thought and think that contrary to what was being announced and said, getting into that situation without any action on our part would be dramatic in terms of non-proliferation, since unlike what was being said, as I just indicated, the situation would not, I repeat, would not be reversible or recoverable. We would be basically flying blind without any idea of what would be taking place in terms of enrichment activities and other relevant activities in the nuclear program of Iran. Irrespective of a happy ending of that process or of that interruption, we would have lost definitively an idea of what might have happened in between. This is why I took an initiative, wrote to the Vice President of Iran and President of the Atomic Energy Organization of Iran, Dr. Salehi, and proposed to come to discuss and to see what could be done in full compatibility with this law that was about to enter into force, or at least that provision of the law, to mitigate to a certain extent our concerns about the loss of information. And this is exactly what we did. We negotiated arduously for a few days, and we came in the end with something which I described as a reasonable result in the form of the public statement that you may have seen, which establishes a bilateral temporary technical understanding between the IAEA and Iran, whereby we will be able to conduct necessary verification and monitoring activities in the Islamic Republic for a period of up to 3 months. I'm sure there will be questions about it. What I can say is that, of course, this is far from an ideal situation, but we need to recognize that we are confronted with a new reality. And it is our conviction that in doing what we did, we can facilitate a smooth return to the previous situation, if that is possible, after the consultations that are going to take place. And most of all, I think we facilitated an easier atmosphere and time for the indispensable diplomacy that will be deployed in the next few days, I hope, in order to bring back some stability to a situation that needs it very, very badly. So I will stop here so we can exchange, listen to the comments, the questions that may come from the audience. But I hope to have been able to give you a glimpse of the vast program in front of the IAEA. So over to you, Corey.
Thank you so much for those remarks. I think that set us up perfectly for the rest of our discussion and touched on a lot of issues and also left a lot of space for further discussion. So I appreciate all of your contributions so far. Ernie, did you want to start off with a question for the Director General?
Yes, thanks, Corey. Actually, I'll make a couple of comments and then a question. First, I really want to thank the DG and the agency for this intervention in Iran. Clearly, it's something that I've spent a lot of time on, as was as Rafael said. But I will leave the questions on that to others. I just want to say that I have consistently, for ever since the JCPOA was signed, stated that it is the verification regime that is really the most important part of the agreement. And so the agency is really at the heart of the agreement, and the 3 months will be critical, pretty much the length of time the administration. I'm sure there'll be more questions about that. Secondly, I want to thank again the DG for a different reason, and that is for raising the issue of nuclear energy at Glasgow, the upcoming COP26. And I put that in a broader context that, frankly, there are too many individuals, organizations, and countries that want to limit the discussion, to exclude nuclear, to exclude carbon capture and sequestration, to exclude negative carbon technologies from the discussion. This is a terrible mistake. We need as much optionality as possible. And I think having the agency out front in promoting that discussion, at least on the nuclear side, is really critical. Finally, my question. I want to go back to the issues of the agency and nuclear security. When I was secretary, we did a lot on trying to make an impedance matching between the nuclear security summits and then the IAEA summits, kind of in a certain sense, taking over that initiative. On the other hand, Mr. Director General, I have to say that in my experience, at least, what we found was not a complete enthusiasm among all the members of the agency. And I'll be explicit. Russia, for example, being less enthusiastic about the nuclear security initiative, perhaps not the budgets. And I'm curious to get your perspective on those kinds of obstacles and your plans for kind of getting past them to this very important agency security initiative.
Well, thank you for the question, which is enormously relevant. I think the good thing and the very, I would say, memorable contribution of the summits and all that happened in the past decade is that it put this issue on a completely different level, and we were able to do things that would have been unthinkable and perhaps unachievable before. But we have to recognize that phase is behind us. We can look back at it with satisfaction. But we need to work on the present reality. What you say is true, is absolutely true. There are countries that, without putting less emphasis, maybe they do not see the nuclear security as something that should be at the forefront of the work, or perhaps is something where they see, and I'm not thinking about the country in particular, but in general, they may believe that perhaps is something that can be dealt internally, satisfactorily, without a need of a global effort. And this is wrong, because we know of the enormity of the challenge, and because we know that the recourse to nuclear material for criminal purposes will most probably be always related to international criminality and not to national. I mean, national crime is not, something or an activity that will look into the area of nuclear material. It's always things that have global impact and global sources, perhaps, and global and or international inspiration. So, but for this, I think the work is enormous, and it requires enormous consequence and perseverance on the part of the agency, because what we need to do is to instill in every member state the need and the necessity to raise the standards when it comes to nuclear security. And in my opinion, that is not impossible to do, not at all. It requires a discriminate choice of instruments and actions depending on regions and countries. Here, we will have to take the lens and the focus and look at specific situations, whereby before we were looking into big problems and tons of material that were flowing around and we needed to take more bold action. Here, the work will look less heroic, maybe, but it will be every bit as important. So we need to work together, and I count on you from NTI and others who think alike to help us do exactly this. I think it is very, very important to depoliticize the debate of nuclear security. And the risk and the possibility that this may happen is still high. So this is the big challenge that we are going to be confronting over the next few years, where we will be working on advisory missions, on national programs. And I must say that there is also a reason for hope. What we see here at the agency is an increasing demand for nuclear security infrastructure, security plans, nuclear security plans. We see a growing request, and we are thinking about having a global program on large public events. Every single large public event taking place in many countries come to us. And this is a very healthy indicator that they have understood. And this goes from football World Cups to Pope Francis visits to G20 summits. So this is fantastic. It's an achievement. We have to capitalize on this because the security infrastructure in many countries has understood this. Of course, this will require resources and this will require a lot of work, but I see a great necessity to continue working on that, Ernie, and we need all the help we can get, and I'm sure NTI will be with us.
Corey, if I could have just one brief follow-up on that. Our NTI's 2020 Nuclear Security Index had the title Losing Focus, which I think is the message. So I think we would love to work with you on regaining focus. Secondly, you mentioned in your remarks cyber and kind of suggested, well, you know, we have new issues besides nuclear materials, but to me, I would think a big concern is the interaction. For example, the vulnerability to theft of nuclear materials can come from cyber intrusions on conventional security systems. And so I'd be curious if you have any statement about how you might look at those kinds of interactions.
Well, I think here what we need to do is to integrate the problems and the solutions. It is rather typical to see that countries having deficits in one area will also have them in other areas. When it comes, for example, to cyber and to the physical, you are referring, and I think you are right. We shouldn't forget the fundamentals. We are not at all thinking about the physical protection. Physical protection is the basis of nuclear security and will continue to be. But it's also obvious that there are other things that need to be tended to. So it's a combination, and it will depend on our ability to master the necessary resources to do that. We are ready. It will be something where my approach is that at this point, what we need is day-to-day work. You know, the summits helped us, gave us the push, and now we have to continue. And let me say something that could be perhaps a bit controversial, but I hope not too much. But you know, having ministerial conferences where we repeat the same things does not necessarily help. And on the contrary, this risks exposing the important international consensus that we have to the political temperature of the day. If you want to get a blessing every 2 years of nuclear security, you are risking it. Let's work on nuclear security. There's so much that needs to be done. And of course, if people want an international conference, let's have it. But in my opinion, we have what we need in terms of international consensus. Now it's about delivering results. This is my approach.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. You won't be surprised to hear that a lot of questions are coming in about Iran, as you predicted in your introductory remarks. So while I don't intend to spend all of our time on Iran, I do think maybe I'll cluster a few of the issues and maybe ask a couple of specifics, and you can choose whether to address those or not. So the general question, of course, is, you know, can you provide more understanding about the agreement reached over the weekend and what will change as a result of that agreement? And we had a couple of specific questions, including modified code 3.1. For those of you not steeped in IAEA narrative, this is the requirement to make early notification of the intention to construct facilities that will eventually need to be under safeguards. And that is part of the CSA, but it's also something that Iran has questioned in the past. And the second specific question was about whether and how this change in the safeguards posture in Iran will affect the ongoing investigation into undeclared activities, and in particular, the particles. The particles that were detected and reported by the IAEA. So maybe you could address all of these together. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I suppose this encompasses many of the questions that may be out there, and you compacted them very nicely. Thank you for that. On the agreement itself, I think it's very important to read, as you know, in diplomacy, every word counts. And when I set foot in Vienna last night, I told the press corps that I was waiting for us, look at what we got. We got by a temporary bilateral technical understanding. Each word has a meaning. First of all, this is temporary. And we can go back to this. What does it mean? For one, it means that it is limited. It is limited in time and limited in, I would even say, value. This can do something for some time, but its sustainability could be questioned. And I think Ernie mentioned some of these ideas in his introduction in the beginning. So it's a temporary thing. It's a bilateral thing, which means that this is a technical understanding between the technical secretariat, the inspector, and one member state. This is very important because here we are not bringing elements of the or responsibilities of other countries, JCPOA members or whoever. This is a vis-a-vis four-eye sort of understanding between the agency and the Islamic Republic of Iran. The next thing is that this is technical. We are talking about inspections, verification, and monitoring activities and how we carry them out. We are not talking about legal issues. We are not talking about political commitments. It is, by the way, not in my authority in the context of the JCPOA. It is in a different context, but not in the context of the JCPOA. And then this is an understanding, all right? It's not an agreement. It's not a, it's not an attachment to any, as you know, there are many, in the glossary of safeguards practice, you have different terms that define different things. So this is the name of the rose. This is what it is. Not more, not less. This is number one. The other important thing is that in terms of the agreement is that it is supplemented, supported by an annex, a technical annex. The annex is confidential because it is in the singular relation of the inspection between as anything else in this area. But I can describe what it is. Without hiding anything, so that people can understand. And this is the philosophy and the essence of this understanding. What is this? This is a system that allows us to continue to monitor and to register all the key activities that are taking place throughout this period, so that at the end of it, we can recover all this information. In other words, we will know exactly what happened, exactly how many components were fabricated, exactly how much material was processed or treated or enriched, and so on and so forth. And this relates to my initial comment of when I said, this is not recoverable, this is not reversible, if we don't do something about it. I went to Iran because we were sleepwalking into that exact situation without somebody doing something about it. So I don't want to aggrandize or embellish what we did. It's a very modest thing, but it is indispensable and gives us the minimum that we need to do this. Some say that it is too little. Some say at the end of it, if Iran wants and there is no agreement, they will destroy this information. Yes, but if at the end of it, there's no agreement, everything is destroyed. There is no confidence anymore. We are back to square one. So knowing what would have happened during 3 months is a small consolation, because you will in any case not know what is happening on the day that you are talking about this. So I hope this is clear in terms of what the understanding is and what it is not. Let's not forget, this is a reality. The AP is gone for now. Hopefully it will return. But this is for other people to negotiate, not me. On this obstruse and opaque title of the modified code 3.1, sounds very techy for us practitioners, but I think you describe it very well and in human language when you said it is what you know it requires you to inform where you are going to start constructing or putting together a facility. And this is very important because we know that there are such activities ongoing and many more that could come. So this is why I very clearly said to our distinguished and respected counterparts, I don't agree. Of course, this is as far as I can go apart from making reports about this, but if this step is taken, I hope I hope it won't be taken, because we said clearly and legally that this type of agreement is attached, is inextricably linked to the normal safeguards agreement that they have. So if they do something about it, they will be in violation of their normal safeguards agreement, which they themselves committed to continue to observe, and which I specifically requested to be mentioned in the bilateral agreement, as you may have seen. And on the other issues that you mentioned, the points where we still need clarification, again, not to use too much jargon here, there are a number of points where Iran needs to reply and to give us answers on particles of uranium and other materials which have been found on places where they shouldn't be. Mm-hmm. The process is ongoing and it has not yielded positive results for now. So this is an activity that continues. And I will be reporting about them next week when the Board of Governors of the IAEA meets for their spring session.
Great. Thank you very much. Let's move on to some other issues that are, I know, high on the priority list. One question that came in that I think also encompasses a number of other comments has to do with kind of the split personality of the agency as a promoter of nuclear energy, but also a guarantor of nonproliferation. And so one question is really, how do you approach the really diverse mission? And some could perceive those missions as sometimes being in conflict sometimes. So how do you approach that from the Director General's perspective? And also, are there lessons that come from the whole of agency approach that really had to be taken as a result of the pandemic that could be drawn for broader, you know, whole of agency approach and integrating safety, security, safeguards with technical cooperation with nuclear energy in ways that may help with efficiencies with the budget stress, but also with effectiveness. As we know, stovepipes rarely help organizations meet their mission effectively. So maybe you could comment on that group of questions.
Well, thank you very much. Again, you are putting together issues that are sometimes difficult to reconcile. So thank you for that very, very good segue into this. Yeah, it's true. The agency has this, is like Janus, the Roman Greek deity. It has two faces, but it doesn't mean it is cheating or it is hiding anything. Everybody knows that we have both. And in reality, we need both. Our two faces are indispensable to our job, because the promotion of nuclear energy, which, by the way, it's in our statute. This I say because some sometimes say, how can you be promoting? Well, it's my statute, you know, it's my job. Maybe there are other places where people want to phase out nuclear energy, and we respect, of course, everybody. But in order to do that, and also in order to facilitate, for example, the indispensable nuclear medicine and radiotherapy, which requires oftentimes nuclear material, you need to couple that with the security, for example, advisory functions or the safety guidance and guidelines and standards. And safeguards as well. So this multifaceted approach is in the DNA of the agency. And interestingly, it is becoming more evident these days, because as we've been discussing when we start to play a role in the pandemic, for example, an hour and a half ago, before I connected, I was in this same room signing a new agreement with the FAO on the pandemic. So we are doing more and more things in this area and others. And he, you know what he was telling me? You know, you guys, you are the only ones who have labs. We don't have labs, he said. The WHO doesn't have labs. The International Animal Organization doesn't have labs. We have an incredible compound here of labs and scientists and technologists doing this job here. So this is growing, and it's indispensable. You were raising an intriguing point there when you said, can this be more integrated? Can one think about these missions being taken in a holistic sort of manner? And here I say yes, but I also say be careful. Why I say this? Because of the risk of politicization and the risk of certain things being seen by countries as a conditionality. And you, as an expert, have been, and also in your public function when you were in government, you've seen that when many developing countries fear the imposition of conditions against delivery of much needed technical cooperation. So I believe that one needs to exercise these approaches with a lot of prudence. And perhaps in this, coming from South America helps me a lot, because I've been dealing with these issues for all of my life. And not only at the normative level, I've been, you know, negotiating contracts for Argentina selling reactors in other parts of the world and doing these kinds of things, and it appears all the time. So I believe, yes, there is potential for that, but it is something that needs to be approached with extreme care.
Thank you. And we're approaching the end of our time, so I'm going to continue to kind of group some topics together. I wonder if I might ask you to tell the future a little bit. You have a lot on your plate now, but we've had a lot of questions about technology and technological development and kind of what are the next challenges. So technology, both from the positive perspective, you know, how might technology help the IAEA mission? But also, how is the emergence of technology, in particular in the nuclear energy sphere, going to challenge the agency's safeguards and safety and security missions? You know, with new kinds of facilities coming online, new kinds of technologies, new kinds of materials, frankly, coming into the civil sector that may not have been before. So maybe you could say something about that group of issues as well.
Thank you very much. Indeed, it is also extremely important. I think I see these things not with fear, but with hope. I just think that I see this, the IAEA in general, the international organizations, we provide a service. So the world does not live for us, we live for the world. So the economy must grow, science must go forward, countries and people need betterment. They need more energy and they need solutions. And it's up to us to find the safety and security and safeguard and non-proliferation practices that will make all of that possible. I have started, much as I believe in working with think tanks and NGOs and reservoirs of talent like NTI, I also believe, and this is also new, at least as I know from the agency, I also believe in a real serious dialogue with industry. And I have started that already. I'm talking to the CEOs of all the big companies in the world that they are in nuclear energy. And I must tell you, they are delighted. They never got a call from the DG of the IAEA. I need to talk to them. They need to talk to me. We need to understand each other. You are talking about SMRs. I've been talking to the NuScale colleagues, and they are very keen on working with us, because they know that for their technology to thrive, they need to do it in a way that will give assurances. And we all know the enormous potential. You know, I received one of the big privileges of many that this job has is that I talk to everybody and everybody comes to us. And I can tell you that not a week passes without a minister of energy from a developing country saying, we need these reactors. What are these reactors, DG? We need them. This is fantastic. So the challenge for us is not to tell them, no, stay away from that. It's not for you. The challenge is for us to look for a renewed, or more than renewed, to a dialogue, to a serious dialogue with industry to make sure that these are safeguardable and securable in the best possible way. It's going to be difficult, but it's not going to be impossible.
Well, thank you so much. And you mentioned civil society, and I know from the questions coming in that there are a lot of organizations and professional societies and others that stand ready to support you in your mission, and you have an army behind you in all of these really important issues. I know that that Secretary Moniz had either a final question or comment, and with the note that we're at the end of our time and we promised to get people out at the top of the hour, I will use this opportunity to thank you, Mr. Director General Rafael. It's great to see you in this new role. I'm sorry that the pandemic has kept me from being able to congratulate you in person, but we look forward to that time. I'll turn it over to Ernie to make a last comment or question.
Yeah, I'm going to add one more question to your plate, Rafael.
Yes.
Following on your last discussion about technologies, I note that you always say nuclear energy, but nuclear reactors have other applications as well.
Yes.
And in particular, I'd love for you to talk about your thoughts about micro reactors and what the agency is doing there.
Yeah, indeed. We are looking not only on that. This is a very important area. And thanks also for reminding me that there are areas like hydrogen production, where we are very active, talking to different providers and giving advice already, or desalination, big projects in the Gulf, where nuclear is going to be playing a major role there. So we are reinvigorating here a little bit of bureaucracy, if you allow me. We are reinvigorating the functions of the Nuclear Energy Department, trying to activate their role in reaching out and looking into stronger ties with technologies and those who are developing them.
Well, let me just say, I would love to collaborate with you on micro reactors in particular. I think enormous applications.
Okay, start preparing because I will call you.
All right. So all right. We are at an end. I think my number one conclusion, which I suspect is shared by the vast majority of our listeners, certainly, is that the agency is in very good hands. And we thank you for that, Rafael. And specifically, again, I can't help but thanking you for your creative and in many ways courageous intervention in Iran, because as you've said, the custody of continuous information is so critical for any chance to get back into the agreement and maybe beyond the agreement. So again, we thank you for that. Thank you for your service. And we look forward to supporting you in all the ways we can.
Thank you.
To all the listeners, of course.
Of course, Ernie.
Go ahead, Rafael. You have the last word.
Thank you very much, Ernie. It has been a privilege to work with you. You know how important working with NTI has been throughout the years. And I'm so glad that we are going to continue and to enlarge this cooperation that we are having. So we are ready for that. And for the rest of the audience, you must know that the IAEA is open, and we are looking forward to as many contributions as we can get. This is a global effort. We are in this all together, and we cannot afford wasting any talent out there. So thank you for that. I wish you a very nice day in Washington. I hope we will be seeing each other very, very soon. And stay safe.